Good evening. Today we are here to listen to the Sanjay Sen Memorial Lecture. Late Sanjay Sen was our president for over 3 decades. With his immense contribution to the industry and our association, before he passes away on 31st August 2001. He was the internationally known personality and the creator of modern leather industry. From 2003, we have been organizing Sanjay Sen Memorial Lecture on his birthday. On this occasion, we also felicitate the toppers in BTech Leather Technology Examination of HBTI Kanpur, MIT Muzaffarpur, and GCLT Kolkata. Now, to start with, I request our Honorable Vice President, Mr. Asit Bhavan Kanango, to welcome our Honorable Speaker and the participants. Mr. Kanango, please.
Good evening and Happy New Year, ladies and gentlemen. Today, since our president is a little bit indisposed, the onus came to me to welcome you all for this 19th Sanjay Sen Memorial Lecture. As you might be aware that in a new calendar year, we start our activities of our association by the Sanjay Sen Memorial Lecture. Then we carry forward with other activities as well. This year, this is the 19th Sanjay Sen Memorial Lecture. The lecture will be delivered by the eminent scientist and environmentalist, Dr. S. Rajavani, Chairman, Asian International Union of Environmental Commission. The topic of the lecture has been fixed as recent technical and environmental developments in world leather sector and future trend in the midst of COVID-19. We all are aware, we have passed a very torrid and troubled year of 2020. Let us hope 2021 will bring in good omen and good happy life. Now, to talk about Mr. Sanjay Sen, as our secretary has pointed out about him, it is like this. Mr. Sen was born on 14th January 1926. He did his Master's of Science in Chemical Engineering from USA. After qualifying from America, he built the National Tannery Company Limited, founded by his grandfather, Sir Neel Ratan Sarkar, to become the largest tannery in India, as well as one of the largest exporters in India in those pioneering days of exports. Mr. Sen was acknowledged as an authority on the leather and leather manufacturers industry with special reference to exports. Mr. Sen had also been the chairman of the Export Promotion Council for Finished Leather and Leather Manufacturers, Kanpur, for well over a decade. Now the organization is being known as the Council for Leather Exports and stationed at head office at Chennai. Mr. Sen was also the past chairman of the Leather Development Council set up by the Ministry of Industry, Government of India. Mr. Sen was our president of our association, that is Indian Leather Technology Association, and chairman of the governing body of the College of Leather Technology. He was the chairman of the Research Council of the Central Leather Research Institute in Chennai. He was the president of the International Union of Leather Technologists and Chemist Society in Geneva in 1999, of which we are one affiliate country member too. He was the chairman of the Third Consultation Committee of Leather and Leather Products Industry of UNIDO in 1984 and was a member of UNIDO's Leather Industry Panel. He had equally intimate connections with engineering industry, pioneered the export of bicycles from India to a number of countries of Africa, Middle East, and Southeast Asia. And he was the president of the Indian Engineering Association, which is now known as the Confederation of Indian Industry, that is CII, and was the chairman of Jagdish Bose National Science Talent Search for about 25 years. In the course of his extraordinary and versatile career, as an entrepreneur, industrialist, and technocrat, Mr. Sen was recognized both by the government and industry as an authority on export promotion. His talents and wide experience and knowledge of exports had led to his appointments to the boards of the Export Credit and Guarantee Corporation, that is ECGC, the Trade Development Authority, Indian Tourism Development Corporation, Indian Institute of Foreign Trade, Indian Standard Institutions. He was also the chairman of International Standard Organization, Geneva, and the Federation of Indian Export Organization, that is FIO. He passed away on 31st August 2001. After that, he has created a void which is still to be fulfilled. And now I would request our Secretary, Mr. Sushanta Mallick, to take over from me. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Kanango. Now, let us felicitate the toppers of BTech from different institutes, as we do every year. I request Mr. Pal to share the awards, certificates, and the recipients' pictures on the screen when I will announce their name. Miss Kritika Bhagmi, she is the winner of Sanjarshan Memorial Medal and certificate for securing first class first in BTech Leather Technology Examination from Muzaffarpur Institute of Technology, Bihar in 2020. Congratulations, Ms. Kritika Bhagmi. We will send your medal to your house address and also the certificate. Second one is Ms. Tanvi Srivastava, the winner of Sanjarshan Memorial Medal and certificate for securing first class first in BTech in Leather Technology Examination from Harcourt Butler Technological Institute, Kanpur, UP in 2020. Congratulations again to Ms. Tanvi. We will send your certificate and medal to your address as specified with us. Now, another Sanjarshan Memorial Gold Medal and Profullo Kumar Basu Memorial Scholarships are given every year with the initiation of Mr. Chandan Basu and Government College of Engineering and Leather Technology. I request Dr. Sanjay Chakraborty, the principal of Government College of Engineering and Leather Technology, to announce the names of the recipients.
Thank you, my beloved secretary. This year, Sanjarshan Memorial Gold Medal Award winner is Mr. Rupendra Paul. He is the topper BTech Leather Technology in the year 2019. There are four recipients of PK Basu Memorial Scholarship, and they are Mr. Rajan Gami, Ms. Nisha Mishra, Ms. Silpa Mundal, and Mr. Shubhajit Mishra. You are all requested to collect your scholarship from the college itself. And Mr. Rupendra Paul, you are also requested to attend the college office to receive the gold medal from the college office, please. Thank you, my beloved secretary.
Thank you, Dr. Chakraborty. We once again congratulate all the award winners. Now let me introduce our honorable speaker, Dr. S. Rajamani. Before introducing, I express our heartfelt thanks to Mrs. Ratna Sen for your kind participation today, like every year. So let me introduce our honorable speaker. Dr. S. Rajamani is a United Nations Industrial Development Organization expert in environment engineering with specialization in cleaner production, waste treatment, and management in world leather sector. He is a doctorate in environmental engineering gold medalist in Bachelor of Engineering degree and first rank holder in Master degree. He has published nearly 120 research publications and many patents, including improved chrome recovery and reuse system, which is universally used technology all over the world. He was a former director in charge of CSIR, CLRI, and served as technical committee member of Anna University. Member in many national and international bodies on leather and environmental protection, education, and many other streams. Served as an independent director in Ambur Economic Development Organization, Leather Sector Skill Council, and other industrial development organization set up. He is an active member of ILTA and long association in the growth of ILTCS for the past 30 years. Served as chairman of International Union of Environment Commission for nearly 20 years and made the commission more vibrant by involving scientific members from India and all the leather producing countries in the world. He is the current chairman of Asian Environment Commission, covering many leather producing countries, including China, Japan, Africa, India, Taiwan, New Zealand, Russian Federation, and European Union, and also UNIDO. Dr. Rajamani has served for many major environmental protection programs and development of leather complexes with CTP in many countries, including Calcutta Leather Complex. Got many awards, such as Indo-Dutch Award under Ganga Action Plan for one of the biggest tannery cluster with CTP in the world. Technology Award for cleaner production, and also some other awards which has not mentioned here. So yes, he is our honorable speaker today. I request Dr. Rajamani to deliver his Sadhyashil Memorial Award. Thank you very much.
Good evening. I would like to thank the ILTA and its organizers for giving me this opportunity to make this Sanjayson Memorial Lecture. This is the second time I got this opportunity. Once again, I thank you. And I'm happy to see you all these things. Wish you all happy New Year. And my topic is the recent technical and environmental developments in world leather sector and future trends in the midst of the COVID-19. And before going to my lecture, I want to say a few words about our visionary, Dr. Sanjayson. I'm also happy that Mrs. Sanjayson also is participating. I recollect my memories. She used to always come with Mr. Sanjayson for all our international conferences, ULTCS things. She used to be very cordial and friendly in all our meetings. Next. We go ahead with the presentation. The tributes. Actually, Sanjayson is a broad-minded visionary, devoted his major part of his lifetime for the development of world leather sector in through various organizations. Because of his international image and capacity, he made ILTA, CSIR, CLRA, and us known to the world leather, instrumental in organizing IULTACS Congress. He's the first time in India, also he's the first IUL Indian president of the IULTCS. He was also instrumental for having good link with the UNIDO. Many programs came to India because of Mr. Sanjayson. Next. So he only actually has identified me when I joined CSIR, CLRI for the environmental program. he nominated me to the IUE commission, paved way to become its chairman, and he always guided us what is the rules, regulations of the IULTCS. And with these motivations and blessings, I got recognitions, international recognitions, and position in technical experts in INIDO, and opportunity and also serve for the world at that. So with this, I will go to my presentation. Next. So if you go there, the world leather production is not increasing. Actually, it is only 1 to 2%. Sometimes it is stagnant. And average, the world leather production is about 16 to 18 million tons of raw hides and skins per year, from raw to semi-finish and finish. But every Indian side, we say it is only 1 to 1.2 million tons per year. That means roughly about 4 to 5%. So we see that wastewater discharge is 2,000 to 220 million liters. And India, so we are having about 100 to 120 million liters. China was the leader, still continue to be the leader, but they have gone up to 24% share. Now it's less than 20 because they diverted their activities to Vietnam, particularly Rot Wet Blue, also to Bangladesh and other places. Italy was the leader around 15 to 17%. But now this year during the pandemic, they have gone down to 4 to 5% like others. Brazil, it was earlier 12 to 14%. This year, due to pandemic, it was worst affected, and lot of deaths, and there is a lot of restrictions, even the process, the raw hides and skins. And India, still 4 to 5% till last year, but this year, everything has gone down below 50%. Next. Next, sir. So the slaughtering of animals is mainly for the meat consumption. That meat consumption itself started reducing in the meat consuming industry, countries like Brazil. Brazil and Argentina, they used to consume about 80 kilograms per year per capita. It's very high, comparing us, maybe 4 or 5 kilos, even that is more. But that has come down by 30% during the last 10 years after this recession in 2008 and 2010. And the America also slightly come down due to economical recession. The Brazil has come down, but further during this COVID-19, due to poor demand from hotel industries, tourism, the further slaughtering also come down, a lot of things. That's why also there is no demand for the hides and skins. Tannery operations further come down 30 to 60%. Some places, during the peak COVID, it has gone down to less than 60%. They were trying to do something with the old orders due to occupational and safety, logistic problem, low market demand, particularly the fashion-oriental shoes, articles, high-value leather articles, closed down all the showrooms in Italy and other cells. Till now it's closed. Only there is some demand for the industrial things and common usage of footwear and other things. But it's not much affected in Kanpur. To some extent, it's okay. Now it is picking up in Calcutta, but it is most affected in Tamil Nadu because they are focusing more on the connection with the fashion-oriented, high-value shoes and garments. In many countries, there is no buyers for even raw hides and skins because they cannot transport. The Brazil, they said, the slaughterhouse itself, they have to process without applying salt up to wet blue. So they did it to some extent. It's all accumulating the wet blue in Brazil, the northern part of Brazil. Next. So this is a major experience, and no one has got this type of experience. And tannery operations, even during the last 10 years itself, it is reduced and further reduced. They prefer to export the salted hides and skins. They found that the environmental cost, labor cost is very high, but they export the raw hides and skins. That's why leather R&D also. When there is no tannery, there is no work. So most of the R&D institutions in US, Europe, almost closed down. That's why there is no publications also from there. Even they don't much participation in international conferences. So they are particularly the high-ended value products are totally closed. The international trade and restriction in logistics movement result in stagnation of raw materials. Sales prices have also come down because there is no demand for the fashion. People like to buy 4 or 5 pairs, different season, different colors. That's all gone. And the confidence levels also, so even using the leather articles, protection against measures in the sanitations. Some people asked me whether you can apply the sanitizer towards the leather purses or articles or blouses. So these are all things to be ensured that it is safe from COVID and it will not affect, it is durable. So these are all the challenges we are facing. Next. So if you see that Italy is the second major high value producing country. Their shares were 14% to 16%. So they are the leaders in high fashion. So even if you are having any fashion parade or fashion, or they were the consultants coming, going to all over the world and the high value products. So it is that international trade promotion activity is almost gone down. Now it is almost stand still, because you may be knowing that they had a lot of link with China, particularly in the product sector and other areas, and they were the first affected by this COVID in the early 2020, end of 2019. So till they could not recover, and again they are having the second round of COVID, and I don't know when the business will pick up. And they have got many effluent treatment plant. They were the first to introduce the common effluent treatment plant about more than 25 years back. So they developed it, but they were the leaders even before India. But they did a lot of work. They converted even the physicochemical treatment into biological treatment, but the central chrome recovery, so many things. But now everything is underutilized. They are in great trouble, and I don't know, even they themselves no idea what will happen in the future. Particularly the future of the Europe is a big question mark, particularly for the high-ended value products and fashion. Next. So the COVID, again, the whole thing is the institutions. The main of the things, if you put in a different angle, why the R&D institutions in US, Europe, they reduced their activities, now almost to close down. Only some partial operations in India, particularly East India, China. So it's all going on, because some operations of leather and are going on, tannery operations. But the functioning of the R&D institutions, university, it is not much affected. They were affected in certain areas in 2019. But 2020, the institutions, the universities almost, particularly the postgraduate institutions, R&D, they restarted in a limited way. The government is also giving a lot of support for the R&D institutions, particularly Chandu. There are a lot of R&D activities. But the industry nowadays, they are linking with the institutions linked with the industries. Whatever cleaner production cost is given to the institutions, universities. Also, the China Leather Industry Association also cooperating with the research institution. They are also getting financial support. So that's why it is doing something. The Russian Federation is also doing operation countries. But US, Europe, it's almost gone down, and there is no feature or sign of new R&D activities there. The local consumptions slowly start picking up, but not for the high-ended values. The recently, this year, particularly last year, 2020, whatever international conferences organized in Romania, particularly Bucharest by the institutions and the Russian Federation, all these things, they changed it into Zoom and virtual mode. Of course, there were good participation presentations, but the response from the participants, particularly the international participants, even though I also participated, but the interactions and the response from the audience is not good, because they present the paper, then they leave it. That way, the once in a way for short meetings, the international Zoom conference is okay, but not for the big international conferences. The Zoom virtual may not be so effective in future. That's what. Even maybe we can have a mixed one. Partially people participate, partially also they allow them to have some in external. Next. So the there are a lot of issues. Still, there is no clear idea. We are going to have the 2021 IUL TCS Congress proposed this year end in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. Still, they don't know whether to have the physical participation, whether to have continue with the Zoom conference, or even though they're calling for papers from April, May, but a lot of uncertainty is still existing. I spoke to the chairman of the conference. Still, he's hoping, but it's all depending upon the development in Europe. If the Europe is not improving, there is some improvement in India and China, but not much in the Europe. So it depends upon that. The things will be clear only in April. The publications also, only few publications are coming now. Thanks to ILTA, you are doing this publication now. China also, they started doing it. But mostly publications are becoming from physical forms to the e-communications. So industrial activities reduced, calm down. The UP is not much affected. They told us it is now, it is about 70-80%, but South India is only 20-30%. Calcutta is slightly peaking up, but environmental protections, the government funding is going on for the CTPs because of the pressure from pollution control boards. A lot of new activities are going on, expansion of CLC in Kanpur, Calcutta, as well as in Kanpur, new mega complex is coming up. It is slowed down in Tamil Nadu, though government is giving a lot of funding for the zero liquid discharge. That seems to be a little big hurdle for this Tamil Nadu tanneries. The ZLD with the production and all come down. I will explain a little later. Next. So this is the lesson we learned. See, actually, when I visited with our team, IULTCS and EU Commission to Lorca, Spain. So at that time, they were doing well about 15 years back. So they were the first, they introduced the centralized effluent treatment plant with zero liquid discharge, the one of the southern part of Spain, Lorca. That's the first incident in the world. So because they were having some water shortage also, like in Tamil Nadu, they built this ETP with reverse osmosis, zero liquid ditch, everything. But within 5 years, they found that they could not manage this high technology, as well as the operation maintenance cost is very high. And even though the government has supported them, within 5-6 years, the entire CTP with 5 million liters capacity, they spent a lot of money, nearly $50 million. At that time, it's 250 crore of rupees, but high value. But unfortunately, that is closed down. That is the lesson we learned. That is what we also warned our Tamil Nadu people, but they were forced to implement this ZLD system. But at the same time, in other CTP in Spain, Igualdia near Barcelona, they were having a simple basic treatment like in Calcutta or Kanpur. So they were treating it. Partly mixing with the domestic treated domestic sewage, it goes to back to the backwaters, like in Calcutta. So also similar to the Kanpur. So that is sustaining, but the zero liquid discharge is not sustained, unfortunately. This is what reflecting now in India. Next. So the leather process, particularly, whoever adopted the zero liquid discharge and all, the main affected is semi-finished to raw to semi-finished because of the high pollution load, not much added value. So it has come down. See, Tamil Nadu share, once it was 55%, came down to 45%. From 40% but 10 years back, now it is less than 25%. Tanning operations, raw to finish or something. The share of Calcutta, it was about 10 more than, but the, it has now slowly picking up from 15 to 20 years. From third position, it has come to second position. Kanpur earlier, it was even less than third position. Now they are number one position. They have gone up to 25. They may go up because first time they also got a new other complexes approved recently near Kanpur with 700 tons of raw material, 18 MLD. So they are going to treat the effluent. They segregate the saline stream and they recover the salt. But the balance will be treated and mixed with the domestic sewage of UP Jal Nigam and will be discharged for irrigation. So the new regulations also give directions for the different type of treatment for the new industries, new segregations. Next. In future, as per the new directions from the National Green Tribunal, Ministry of Environment, Forest and other things, because of this salinity, it's not a big problem in Kolkata, but it's a problem in landlocked areas, Kanpur, Tamil Nadu and all. What they have directed, you have to segregate, either you should process salt less, but it is not so easy. You don't have organized slaughterhouses. But when you are doing the soaking with the salt hides and skins, that should be segregated. You should have a treatment and you should go in for water recovery with UFRO. And the salt should be will be a quality salt because we are not mixing with any other stream. The quality salt will be reused. It's a quality 99% purity. So that has a mandatory two CTPs they started implementing in Bantar and Unnao. The chromium will be also taken out from individual chrome recovery to a centralized. The chrome will be recovered in the form of a cake and powder. It's the improved system approved by MOEF. We had also demonstrated. So that will be given back after reconditioning using the chromate factory. It will go back to the tanneries. The low saline, semi-finished to finish or other streams will be treated and it will be mixed with treated domestic sewage. This is the scheme is likely to be adopted in most all the CTPs and also the new complex, mega leather complex approved recently, Kanpur. Next. So now the thinkings are changing because the another major problem faced by the our effluent treatment was sludge. So when you are going for a chemical treatment, so the conventional process, a lot of lime, sulfide, and a lot of sludge is also generated. To neutralize the chemical, we also add more chemicals in the pH adjustment in the effluent treatment plant. So now Italy and all, they are changing the entire physiochemical into total biological, no, preferably minimum or no chemical. So we use a special aerators with a deep tank instead of top to bottom horizontal ejection. These are all being tried in first time in Pallavaram in Tamil Nadu and in all the CTPs in Kanpur and other things. It is an improved system. It is followed by further improvement from the Italian systems, but it's all totally becoming a biological system. Though sludge volume will reduce, the bio sludge also can be used for composting. Next, sir. So that is what is the lessons we learned. So another thing is, so we, even nowadays the new thing is we found there is no standard for the color. When you discharge it into color. But people, they don't accept when there is, the water is not clear. So for that, they insist on the advanced oxidation system by using ozone. So that ozone, what is happening is, it reduces the residual COD and color, the microbes, the end of the treatment after tertiary treatment. It gives a good color. And also in the meantime, we found in most of these hospitals in South India and all, even against cancer or something, instead of oxygen treatment, if you give the ozone treatment to the patients, the growth of the viruses, the cancer viruses, even COVID viruses, they are reduced when you use vitamin C and the ozone treatment. The oxygen level in the blood also goes up, and they found it is a better thing. There is a lot of scope for not only for the effluent treatment, also the people treatment. The vitamin C and the ozone treatment will be a better effect in COVID. There is not much side effect. That's what they have found. Next. So what are the lessons we learned? So whatever technologies developed, CLRI, CSR, they are all developing cleaner technologies. A lot of improvements, saltless sites and chromeless scanning. So many things are there. But the cleaner technologies, what I found, what I learned, should be made simpler. So we have to make it so simpler. And even a common technician in the site should be able to understand. And it should be well demonstrated in the field. So that's what we learned. Even the UNIDO and other things, they spend a lot of money, not only for the development of the technology, for the demonstration. So that's why this chromacurry was, to some extent, or even now it's become mandatory, because it's well demonstrated, made it simple, and it should be commercially acceptable universally, because not only it is acceptable by us, our buyers also should accept it. So this is the one our scientists should understand. And you should have more interaction with the technocrats. It should be a joint activity by the research and the industry. And of course, ILTA also can play. You have got a lot of other technologies, knowledgeable people. You can also like CLA, China and other industries are operation. They are doing a lot of coordinations and interactions. So they do the dissemination. You are doing a lot of dissemination technology developed to the industry. Many countries, high labor costs, unsustainable regulations, they are closing down their tanneries. Why they are exporting? Because of the, the industry is not sustainability because of the environmental and cost. But correspondingly, R&D institutions are also existed. And also the operation maintenance cost, the effluent treatment plan. If you see the simple system, the treatment cost, discharge into the backwater like Calcutta or something, or dilution, it will be around 50 rupees per meter cube. But when you go in for a zero liquid discharge or very high tech in Italy, where the sludge is totally mineralized, it goes up to 5 euros, 7 euros. Now in Tamil Nadu, it is 500 rupees meter cube. So where is the difference between, lot of difference, 50 rupees to 500 rupees. That means 0.7 USD to 7 USD. So much difference. So how do you think that it will sustain? That is the reason the first zero liquid discharge in Spain, it has gone up to 7 to 8 euros. Slowly when the capacity utilization go down, it has gone up, then finally it is closed down. So this is the major deviation. We should see that the O&M cost should be much less. One thing what I fear, I think nowadays for the ZLDC projects, the government, DAPP, is continuously giving support every 5 years for upgradation of ZLD, but there is no expansion. But with the promise of expansion, we means the industries got money from the DAPP with the export. Now they are scared. They may not give funding. If they don't give continuous funding, the sustainability of high-cost effluent treatment plants will become a big question. Next. So the connection, if you see that, the technology, if you see that whatever technology developed in Europe earlier, what they followed, their system is, everything is controlled. See, if you did whatever technology they did, it is all thermo-controlled, then the heating system. So they do with all equipments or no leakage. Then Asia, it's all different. Asian operations are different. So only thing you can see some linkage only in Turkey or East European things. So they partly they adopt similar technologies, brought to red blue like this without air conditioning or control. natural climate conditions there. But the finishing, they adopt the Europe, totally Europe, their missions, because they are exporting there. So this is the good link. There is some activities going on in Turkey, particularly Izmir and all. Some institutions, East Europe and all, they are still working. But West Europe, no activity. Thanks to Turkey, East, so that for us opportunity to how it is we are able to connect with Asia and Europe. Next. So the again, Asian countries, what we found during this incident, COVID, immediately after the end of COVID 2019, they started giving, they also called me, the IELTA president, you know, he's sitting next to me. So he called me, what is the incentives given in India and other places, and they are evaluated. They are given a lot of incentives for the exports. They wanted to push as much as possible, and a lot of flexibilities they are given, and credit, all these things they have done. And also they are focusing more on the finished products and other things. Raw to semi-finished, they slowly diverted the operations to our Bangladesh, Vietnam, where cheap labor, not much environmental conditions. But I was thinking that, everybody was thinking that Japan is almost gone out of leather process. But I was surprisingly knowing they do very high quality, limited number of cow, developing a special breeds. It's interesting, some of people may be knowing it. What they are doing, they don't grow cows or something like eating grass ours, but they breed, develop breeds like in Kobe and other places. It's a patented development. So they identify the breeds, they give milk or grass, something. They are started giving liquor. Liquor means beer. Every day, small cow will take 1 to 2 bottle of beer, and 4 or 5, they give body massage. And after a year or something, they slaughter. And the skin also is very soft and different. They do the specialized to leather process. The meat is exported to America and South America. It is called Kobe meat. That meat is 4 times costlier than our meat. Our meat may be 700, 800, 600 rupees per kilo. That is 3,000, 4,000. So that type of specialized work they are doing in Japan. And a lot of Asian university only do some research there. They say there's some work is going on in Japan, but China, they are cooperating with Japan. Japan, most of their work, they are getting it done in other countries, China, Vietnam, and other things. They do advice, chemical process, and other things. Next. So Asia, they, again, what I was telling, that is not possible in India. China, they close down all the tanneries. If it is less than 10, 15 tons capacity, the small scale tanneries all vanished. They keep only more than 10 tons. They process the 2 semi-finished finish. So they shifted all the semi-finished, raw to semi-finished Vietnam, Bangladesh. There are 13 CTPs in China, but all, if a CTP means they don't have 300 to 400, they have got only 20 tanneries, but even 20 tanneries, they will have 20 million liters. So like that, one tannery will discharge 1 million liters. So they're very big, but now it is, the capacity is less than 50%. So they are also facing problems, but the government is supporting a lot of incentives to the, particularly tanneries and export. Next. So the research is still going on. So because the students still, they don't mind doing all sorts of subjects. The culture is in China is different from us. Our people, they study leather technology, they go for IT and other things. But they don't mind doing all sorts of, even educated person, they do and go and work, any type of work. So that way still some tannery operations and R&D, all these things are still going on in China. But if you see that, it is a really good model. What I found in this 15 to 20 years, the China Leather Industry Association, CLA, like our ILTA, is playing a major role. So they interact with the universities, they interact with the IULTCS Congress or Asian Congress. Of course, they have come to India also. And also they are getting some funding, all the staffs, core staff, and all their publications are supported by the government. So that's what you are doing, a lot of services. We should also expect some support from the government, state or CLE or somebody. So they are organized the last Asian Congress 2018, and they are going to organize the IULTCs also in 2023. Next, in Chandu. So these are all the recent developments, and the main focus is the main industry is the chromium is no more toxic. It's we are using only trivalent. That is acceptable to Europe and America and all. The sulfide usage should be drastically reduced. That is the one causing major problem, water. That should be reduced at least by 80%. The salt, slowly. It's not a problem, much problem in Calcutta, but other places. The salinity aspect is should be reduced. This is the major problem in many other countries also. Even if you go in for Cairo, all the tanneries were shifted from the Cairo city to the coastal area near the desert area near Suez Canal. So the salinity is becoming a problem because when the river water salinity goes up, they cannot use it for drinking. So their focus will be there, salting the processing the unsalted hides and skins, and then we should think of organized slaughterhouses. What is happening in Brazil is all the organized slaughterhouses, they are not supposed to apply salt and sell the hides. They are supposed to do the raw to wet blue or semi-finishing without applying salt, keep it cold storage, then only they are applied to sell it. So because they are groundwater, the surface water is a major problem. You might have read a few years back, one of the managing director of the effluent treatment plant was put into jail for 10 months in Brazil. Now they are in very bad shape. The separate treatment of soap is coming in India, chrome. So again, whatever technology these guys are developing in Europe, but not by the some textile unions and other chemical industries, they apply the dyes and other things in a powder form and the gaseous form like that, very high pressure controlled chamber, like, you know, the your reverse osmosis, you apply 50 bar, 60 bar. With the high pressure, it goes in. There is no residual water or something like that. But you require high investment, then the materials. The materials should be consistent in the large quantity. So that's why they feel you, when you're developing a tannery, you should have the end product should be in limited range. And also the raw material should also be selected. Then the high-tech values will have a, like upholstery leathers and airlines heights and all. That is why they make money. And these are all the things we have to learn. Next. So they discontinued in R&D. See, many people, how to force US or Europe to, they produce a lot of hides and skins, but they don't do any research on the leather process and also the effluent treatment plan. If the salted hides and skins are banned for export, because Europe, US, they don't allow any agricultural product, putrescible product to go in. At the same time, they export the putrescible hides and skins, supplying dirty salts to developing nations, India, China, wherever, Africa. But they stopped the R&D. So if they're forced, at least you should do R&D, then they have to put the effluent plant and they have to start the R&D. So this, but it is very difficult questions, only the international level somebody should take up. Then Italian model, what they are doing, the capacity utilization. If you see that, the small scale is surviving. They do certain operations. At least they see the 80% capacity is utilized. They had a cooperation and industrial organizational setup. So then again, continued R&D. It's all integrated with the industrial operations, reduction in recovery of the cleaner technology, solid waste, environment college cost also should be sustainable so that the carbon footprint, that is one of the major issues. recently we claim that it is good, but it is, when you see the carbon footprint, it is not sustainable. So we have to see certain things in a different way and for the future. Next. So the COVID challenge is faced all over the world, but still it is not clear what is going to happen. But very high fashion oriented goods, value products still have difficulty, because the whole thing is the protection is there. Everybody wanted putting your mask and other protections. That is the question of fashion shoe or something like that. So this is the whole problem. And revival depends upon the, again, irrespective of the COVID-9 closure or something, there will be a lot of importance will come in the occupational safety measures, the flexibility, mobility, control of COVID will come in a different form. Regulations will be more, environmental cost will be more, occupational cost will be more, irrespective of COVID-19. And so then the occupational safety, but we have to see the productivity, less labor, optimizing these things, then only we can survive. And we have to improve the image, like cotton textiles, organic farming, the image of genuine leather. It should be linked with some health aspects. So it should be effective. Otherwise, it's very, very critical situation to come out of this difficult situation, and the sustainability is a big question mark. I'm not discouraging, but it is a big challenge. Next. Anyway, thank you so much, because with the limited time, I could not go much deep with the available data, the input from ILTA, UNIDO, many European countries, and our industrial association. So I could get some feelings. So the things, whatever I present, may change, but it's a very challenging position we are in it. And again, once again, I thank ILTA for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts. You are also aware of many developments. I congratulate ILTA for organizing regular Zoom meetings. And I think you are the one, you are continuing. I think nobody is doing in this country, and even Asia also. China also, they're because of this other logistics and language, they are unable to organize some big Zoom meetings. And I congratulate you. I thank Sanjay-san. I still recollect, because of him, I got confidence. I go to IULTCS, IUE Commission. So whenever we go, actually, really a great man. Each and every time he used to come to the IULTCS at his own cost. I have seen that with his missus. And even though I was young, then he used to take me, he used to sit with me, how to voting of this IULTCS Congress, how to deal with the, introduce with the people. And really, it's a vision, and we cannot forget. Also, I appreciate ILTA remembering him, organizing this without the regularly. And again, it's hope the IULTCS Congress will be organized in November, Addis Ababa. Then 12th Asian Congress in New Zealand, 23 in Chengdu. So our CLRA director was also thinking of ILTA also, they told me, Nabza, thanks, you should recover fast. And we are thinking of getting again IULTCS in 2025, also the Asian Congress in future. So I should again thank you, and once again, also support for the ILTA organizes in my presentation, because there are some difficulties in technical difficulties. I should thank you for my support, your support in making the presentation. Hope I made it a little bit clear to you, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Rajamani, for your elaborative address. And in fact, the statistics that you have provided is of really interesting. Of course, we have crossed a torrid time in 2020. And because of these different lockdowns in whole of the world, as well as work from home, the leather industry has suffered a lot. In case people will be living in their home and working from there, naturally they don't need any leather products for that. A slipper will do. But however, in this coming year, in this year itself, 2021, the things may change and it may look up. But of course, what you have expressed about the cost factor of the environmental standards. Along with that also, this REACH compliance and the LWG standards that is been imposed upon the tannery manufacturers are going to be a costly episode as well. But however, let us hope for the best for this year. And thank you for your elaborative speech. Probably in 2020, the ASEAN International Congress has to be conducted in India. Let ILTA decide on that aspect, because in 2018, China has made it, and probably the, now the term comes to India. We have to see whether we can conduct it or not because of this present day situation. However, thank you, sir, again. And now I would request our General Secretary, Mr. Sushanta Mallick, to deliver your vote of thanks. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kanango. On behalf of our association, I express my and all the participants, including our members, Sanjayan Memorial Lecture, focusing mainly on our sustainability in this turmoil situation due to COVID-19. Our association will remain grateful to you, Dr. Ayawani. We'd also like to express our appreciation to the award winners for their achievements. Wishing a very happy and prosperous new year for you and your family. Thank you very much.